about if we all take a minute and stand up and wave to one another right now so I don't forget it later in the service? Everybody wave. If you're able to stand up. Oh, there's people in the balcony too. Don't forget them. All right. Well, in the secular world, this is Labor Day weekend. Sorry. In the secular world, this is Labor Day weekend. It's an opportunity to get a breather, a calm from the pressures of the working world. In the Christian world, this is a reminder of the calling of work and how we must have a balance between work and rest. This is something that should happen every single day and every single week, actually. It's called Sabbath. Sabbath, which is a way of recognizing our limits and honoring our limits as a part of our God-given existence. Sabbath means to breathe. To breathe. We take that for granted, don't we? To breathe. To be breathed upon. Or to be refreshed as if by a current of air. As we gather this morning to worship, if you are weary, worn out, or exhausted, you've come to the right place. And I invite you right now, let's take a deep breath from down here, not up in our diaphragm, but from deep in our belly. Let's take a deep breath right now. And then breathe it out. One more time, we're breathing in God's Spirit and out all our anxieties, frustrations, weariness. Let's do it together. Breathe in. And now let's breathe it out. And be still. And know that God is real. God is here. And God longs for us to open ourselves to God's presence. Breathe. And let us begin our worship for this beautiful, gracious day.
Thank you. Good morning. We have the following announcements. By the way, what an awesomely perfect weather outside the last 3 days. Yeah, this is great. Please keep the following in your prayers. Irene Leininger, Eleanor Morgan, Viral Geyer, Joanne Dammeyer, George Turpin, Dot Silver, Cheryl Klein, Deb Perry, the daughter-in-law of Ron and Cheryl Klein, Ed Goldnetz, John Long, David Freewald, and as always, all of our military and emergency service personnel. Donnie Carroll is recovering at home after a brief hospital stay. We were very sad to learn Mary Alice Stoner passed away this past Wednesday evening. Her body is being donated to science, and so a private family memorial will be held this afternoon. Please keep Cindy and Jim, as well as her brothers, in your prayers. If you note, there's something in the bulletin about this, but they had been printed prior to knowing that she had passed, so disregard what the bulletin has. Altar flowers today are for Mary McDonald in memory of her husband, Tom. And don't forget about our liturgist and flower sign-up sheet back by the sound system. Any other announcements, joys and concerns?
Are Ted and Nicole Dickey here today?
Ted and Nicole Dickey, are they here this morning? Their son was just confirmed last Sunday. They recently transferred their membership to our church, and I wanted to present them with their certificates, but we'll just keep on bringing it up every week until they show.
Okay. If there are no announcements, this is a September birthday day, and we have a birthday, by golly. My wonderful husband, today is the day. Now, out of respect for my elders, I won't say how old he is, but it's one of those big ones with a zero at the end. Yeah, so you can guess from there. Sadly, he still looks younger than I do, so yeah. So we know Glenn has to stand. Anybody else with a September birthday? Looks like you're it, guy. Oh, there we go. Okay.
What? No, I'm up again.
I didn't read very well, did I? Would you please stand and join me in the call to worship? We run the race of life every day. This, however, is our chance to stop, pray, and feel the power of God's love surround us. God is deserving of the worship we offer now. Let us wholeheartedly praise our Creator with all our might, for we are the children of God. Please join me in the unison prayer. Oh God, we have lots of our own ideas and wisdom about how to serve, yet we also want to fall in line behind you. We want to follow your lead, hoping to live your healing actions, pass your word down the line. We seek to love in the way you love. We listen now for your direction. We watch now to follow your gestures. Teach us in this worship. Amen.
Thank you.
That was beautiful, Leslie. Thank you so much. I love that hymn. We only usually hear it at Thanksgiving time, so I think it's wonderful for us to hear it more than just that time of year. Well, hopefully you are remembering the intention that I set for us this morning as we started our service, which is to breathe. So once again, let us take a moment to focus now as we come together on this Labor Day weekend and join together listening for God who is speaking to us always. Almighty God, when you lovingly formed us out of the dust of the earth, you breathed into us the breath of life and gave us work and purpose for living. You placed Abraham in the Garden of Eden to till and keep it. And through our work, you have made us co-creators with you, shaping the world in which we live. And we give you thanks this day for providing varieties of work and for blessing us by our labor. For those who plow the field, for farmers and farm workers, for those who work with their hands and those who move the earth, for all who provide food for others, we give you thanks, O Lord. For those who tend the sick and those who seek new cures, for doctors and nurses and scientists and technicians, for all who work to care for the sick, we give you thanks, O Lord. For those who design and create, for inventors and explorers, for artists and musicians, for those who write books and those who entertain, and for all who open windows on their world through art and music, we give you thanks, O Lord. For those who work in offices and those who work in warehouses, for secretaries and receptionists, for stockers and bookkeepers, for those who market products and for those who move them, and for all who serve others through administration, we give you thanks, O Lord. For those who inspire our minds and those who motivate us, for teachers and students, for public servants, for those who help the poor, and those who work with our children, for all who encourage us to learn, we give you thanks, O Lord. For those whose labor is tidiness and cleanliness, for janitors and sanitary workers, for dry cleaners and maids, for those who produce cleaning products and for those who use them, and for all those who add beauty and cleanliness to your world, we give you thanks, O Lord. For those who serve in the armed forces, for soldiers and airmen, sailors and marines, for all those who put themselves in harm's way to protect others, we give you thanks, O Lord. Send your special favor on the unemployed, the underemployed, and the disabled, that they might find work that enriches their lives and provides for their families. Give health to the sick, hope to the bereaved. Make us loving and responsible in all that we do. And hear us now as we pray the prayer Christ taught us, saying in one voice, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. During this time of offertory, we will be watching a video which is entitled Seven Wonders of the World. It invites you to think about why it is that you give so generously to the ministry here at St. Paul's. And if you forgot when you walked in, we do have the offering plate over there, and it will remain there until after the service. So if you want to drop your offering there, you may do so following the service. Thank you, God, for your faithfulness, your generosity. Help us to remember that everything we've been given in life, even the work that we do, the paycheck that we bring home, all has been given to us by you. And so our offering is our way of saying thank you and giving back to you so that others may be blessed as well. We ask your name and your blessing upon this offering today. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
Our scripture readings this morning first comes from Psalm 22, verses 25 to 31. From you comes the theme of my praise in the great assembly. Before those who fear you, I will fulfill my vows. The poor will eat and be satisfied. Those who seek the Lord will praise him. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations will bow down before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. All the rich of the earth will feast and worship. All who go down to the dust will kneel before him, those who cannot keep themselves alive. Posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord. They will proclaim his righteousness, declaring to a people yet unborn, he has done it. And our second reading is from 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 21. Now the theme here is love. So I would challenge you to count how many times you hear the word love in this passage. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and his love is made complete in us. This is how we know that we live in him and he in us. He has given us his Spirit, and we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them and they in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in them. This is how love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. In this world, we are like Jesus. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. Whoever claims to love God yet hates a brother or sister is a liar. For whoever does not love their brother and sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. And he has given us this commandment: anyone who loves God must also love their brother and sister. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thank you, Linda. She asked me if I was going to ask her for the answer, and I said no. No pop quiz today. I tell you the answer if you listen. That's your little commercial break. Abraham Lincoln was once criticized by an associate of his for his generally congenial attitude toward political rivals. The associate asked, "Why do you always make friends with your rivals? You should destroy them." To which Lincoln replied, "Am I not destroying my enemies when I make them my friends?" Lincoln's words are wise ones for our day and time. In this age of hyper-partisanship, mistrust, and the loss of open and honest dialogue, they seem like echoes from some far off, distant utopia. We have lost the art of civil discourse, it seems. Forgotten, as my pastor and mentor, Reverend Ken Gelhaus, once said, the ability to disagree agreeably. We are more divided than ever. And at the root of this divide, it seems, is something more than the inability to get along, more than the inability to be kind and cordial. It is at its very heart a loss of the ability to love. I have chosen for this fall the theme rooted in love. You and I, we are grounded in the rich, fertile soil of this faith community and of the love of God. And from that rich and fertile foundation, and by the grace of God, we are able to grow in various ways. And so for the next five Sundays, we'll look at some of the ways we grow in discipleship, in hospitality, in generosity, in gratitude, and today in love. And you and I would be hard-pressed to find another passage of Scripture that delves deeper into this matter of love than our Scripture reading for today that Linda just shared with us. And she asked you before the passage was read to count how many times you heard the word love. The first is probably obvious, love. And if you are counting, the word love appears 30 times in the passage. 30 times. And every time it is a particular word for love that is used, it is the Greek word agape. Agape. Quick Greek language lesson here. The Greeks had three different words for love. One was eros, used for physical or sexual love. The other was philios, the kind of love that's found in friendship. And the third word, agape, actually was the least used of all three. Agape love is that love that transcends physicality or mere acquaintance, something more than a feeling, more than something that comes and goes like the wind. Some have taken to describing agape love as love in action. Interesting, isn't it, that while agape may have been the least used word for love back in the day, here in this particular passage, it is used every single one of the 30 times. There's another word you may have heard a few times as well, and that is the word abide. The Greek word meno can mean to reside, to lodge, to settle, to endure, something that is permanent, something that lasts. And six times this word appears here. It was Aristotle who once famously said, "We are what we repeatedly do." Seems like the writer of 1 John had the same thing in mind here. Love, abide. Let agape love reside or endure in us. And it seems simple enough, doesn't it? Not exactly an earth-shattering message at face value. Conjure up any of the well-known love exhortations in our own day and time. Think about the one that Bishop Michael Curry used from Harry and Meghan's wedding. There is power in love. Do you remember him saying that? How about the Beatles? All you need is love. Charles Dickens said, a loving heart is the truest wisdom. How about Lenny Kravitz? We've got to let love rule. Or Shakespeare, love asks no questions. I could go on, and I'm sure you could too. And that's the problem with love. It's obvious. It's right there in front of us. It's what we know we're supposed to do, which makes it all the more difficult to do. That's why words like Abraham Lincoln's are noteworthy, because they seem so counterintuitive. It's one thing to feel love because feelings are fleeting. It's another thing to act in love because our actions mean something. So what can happen when agape love truly abides or lives in us? Growing up in Wisconsin, I still have that, you can hear it, that nasal thing, Wisconsin, don't you? Okay, growing up in Wisconsin, I spent a fair amount of time together with one particular friend who lived a couple of streets over in my neighborhood. We'd get together and sometimes we'd ride our bikes, or we'd watch a movie, or we'd toss a frisbee in her backyard, or we'd play badminton. Does anybody know what game that is? Although we always had to tread carefully when throwing our frisbee because my friend's backyard backed up against a fence, and on the other side of the fence was the yard of Ms. Schaubel. And you did not want to cross Ms. Schaubel. In fact, we gave her the nickname Shotgun Schaubel. Almost every time we were out there, Ms. Schaubel would come out and yell at us over the fence, accusing us of crazy things. We were being too loud, or we were scaring her cat. We never saw a cat. Maybe that's because we were scaring it, but I wasn't sure. One time we were playing badminton and the birdie went flying over the fence and into her yard, and we didn't get the badminton birdie back. Even my friend's parents couldn't make any headway with Ms. Schaubel. The two of us were convinced that Ms. Schaubel was some minion sent by the devil himself, because there was just no explaining her and how she treated us. Most of the time, I assumed Ms. Schaubel was just born the way she was. But every once in a while, I would wonder about her, who she was, where she was from. I wondered if she ever married or had kids. I know I never saw anybody else with her. I wondered if she'd always been this way, mean and spiteful, or if something that happened in her life that caused it. I wondered what she did at Christmas when all of us were celebrating with our families, or on her birthday. Did she have a cake? Who came to her party? I wondered if she had anyone who loved her, or if she had anyone to love. I wondered all these things. But then she'd yell at us and I'd stop wondering. One afternoon, I walked in the front door of my friend's house, which led right into the kitchen. I saw my friend standing there, and she was opening a bag of Chips Ahoy chocolate chip cookies and placing them on a paper plate. I told her that chocolate chip cookies would be the perfect snack before we went outside and played a little frisbee. And that's when my friend told me that the chocolate chip cookies were not for us. She covered them with saran wrap and took them out to her backyard. I followed her all the way to the edge of the fence, wondering what in tarnation was going on. And then, without warning, I watched my friend step up on a stump, which was against the fence, and lean over into Miss Schaubel's yard, calling her neighbor by name, Miss Schaubel. I thought she lost it, honestly. What was she doing? Sure enough, I heard Miss Schaubel's back door swing open. She made a beeline to the fence, fire in her eyes, and stopped just a few feet away from us. And with a voice that conjured every ounce of hate and malice, Miss Schaubel belted out, "What do you want?" My friend was calm, so calm, beyond calm, as she extended the plate of chocolate chip cookies and told Miss Schaubel they were for her. Ms. Schauble froze. Then she glared over at me as if to gauge whether this was some kind of joke. To be honest, I was wondering the same thing myself. But it didn't seem to be. My friend stood there holding that plate of cookies so calm. Ms. Schauble took slow and deliberate steps to meet her at the fence. She took the plate of cookies from her, then lifted them to her face and peeled back the saran wrap and began sniffing them, as if she was checking for traces of poison or something. Either that, or she was just taking in the sweet aroma of store-bought chocolate chip cookies. Ms. Schauble looked at us, clearly uncertain what to do, because this was the last thing she expected from either one of us. She continued looking at us in silence with an expression neither one of us could read. And then, at long last, a faint trace of a smile broke out, revealing itself cautiously and with much effort, as if it had been a long, long time since her facial muscles had contorted like this. And for the first time that I could remember, she spoke to us in a tone that did not suggest anger. "Thank you," she said. "I like chocolate chip cookies." And with that, she turned and walked back to her house with her plate of cookies, nibbling on one as she went inside. It took us a little while to get used to this new Miss Schauble. I mean, she wasn't totally changed. It wasn't like she came over and started tossing around frisbees with us or anything. But she did give us our badminton birdie back, and the cookies she started baking and giving us on that same paper plate far exceeded anything bought in the store. And she didn't yell anymore. And she actually brought her cat out to meet us. Now, I never asked my friend what possessed her to do what she did that day. Maybe it was because I didn't need to. Because love in action needs no explanation, really. It vouches for itself. And in the end, it's not just about changing the other person. It's about changing ourselves, too. They say that love is the stuff of Valentine's Day and mushy love songs. They say love is "I heart you" etched in the tree trunks and hugs and kisses. But the kind of love the writer of 1 John writes about, the kind of love Jesus lived, is everything about stepping outside our comfort zone and extending our very selves, not just into the places where they'll be warmly received, but also where they may be very well be torn to pieces. Love, agape love, is about standing on a stump and leaning over a fence with a plate of chocolate chip cookies, no matter what comes out of the back door when it swings open. Love is about living faithfully in a world paralyzed by uncertainty and fear, something we live with every single day, every news cycle seeming to up the ante one more notch than the day it did before. Love is about living in the kind of world and choosing against every instinct and despite advice to the contrary, to refuse to let uncertainty and fear take hold of us. Love is about confronting head on the forces in our world that subjugate, that dominate, that reek of injustice and work diligently for reconciliation and redemption. Love is volunteering to prepare or serve food during St. Paul's Breaking Bread community meal, offering not just a meal, but kindness and support found only in fellowship with one another. Love is the doctors and nurses and aides who care for the COVID patients quarantined in Otterbein, putting themselves and their families at risk for someone already at risk with age and illness. Love is the policeman who responds to a domestic dispute and delivers the wife or girlfriend to a shelter, and not just blowing off the dispute as a misunderstanding. Love is listening, active listening, with ears attuned and attention focused on one who has deeply wronged you, while you seek to understand where healing might begin. Love is people in our congregation like Bernie and Marilyn, Bob and Carol Weish, Susan and Ken Braun, and many others who each have individually, Jeanette Tangeman right here, who, and Terry, who put their needs of their spouse before their own, demonstrating the best meaning of agape love. Love is the Black Lives Matter protester who provides a bottle of water to a white supremacist dry with thirst from vocalizing hate, with full acceptance of the other's humanness in spite of the expanse that divides them. Love, quite simply, is about looking upon a world full of fear and hate and choosing to be kind. May you and I, followers of this great agape love, bridge the gap that divides us by sharing a plate of chocolate chip cookies. Let us pray. Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God. May I be like you. Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God. May I be like you. Would you stand now, if you're able, for the benediction? Though I may speak with bravest fire, and have the gift to all inspire, and have not love, my words are vain, as sounding brass and hopeless gain. Though I may give all I possess, and striving, so my love profess, but not be given by love within, the prophet soon turns strangely thin. Come, Spirit, come. Our hearts control. Our spirits long to be made whole. Let inward love guide every deed. By this we worship and are freed. Go in peace. Amen.